Good morning.
Good morning.
I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright and in the congregation. Welcome to Christ's Church, UCC. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are indeed welcome here. Let us first of all give a round of applause to everybody celebrating a birthday this week, specifically. On the 18th, Marilyn McCown. On the 22nd, Al Angston. On the 23rd, Debbie Barnhart. And on the 24th, and I'm sure he's listening in, Ed Chang. Happy birthday to everybody. Before our scripture readings this morning, please hand any prayer intentions to the ushers. And amongst the other announcements you'll find in your bulletin, please note to save the date for our Fall Fellowship Day, otherwise known as Rally Day, which is on Sunday, September 8th, following our worship service. We will have food, fun, and music to make sure to invite your friends. A discerning mind is more to be desired than great wealth or long life. A heart that distinguishes good from evil is more to be sought than earthly power or prestige. Please stand in body or spirit. Calling all children of the living God, the gospel is good news for every age and every stage. The good news is proclaimed in God's word and also with crayons, silly songs, snacks, and rest time. We come together with different abilities and disabilities, learning in a rainbow of ways and styles. All are welcome in the arms of Christ, who proclaimed, "Let the children come." You may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, you can't say you can't hear me today. So, on your way out, the ushers have pieces of cloth like this. And First United has asked us to either put a prayer intention or a verse or sign something you're thankful for part of their unity celebration, which you all have been invited to next Sunday. Starting at 12, the music kicks off, so you have time after our worship to do whatever you want. And they'll have different bands playing and music and food, so you're welcome to be there. And in case you're not familiar with First United Methodist, which is catty corner to Hills Funeral Home. So they're inviting you. And if you would, even if you're not going, fill one of these out during fellowship, and you can just put them on the round table under Reverend Wabi's portrait in Wabi Hall, so I can take them later to my colleague this week. Let us pray. God, our teacher, who helps us to understand the world around us, thank you for the privilege of education. You have blessed our communities with teachers who take new skills and concepts and pass them along to each new class of young people. God, who came as a child to show us how to be fully human, to show us how to be children of God, you have given our children minds that grow and develop in unique ways, at unique speeds, and we are astounded by that miracle. You speak to us through the words, actions, play, and feelings of children. You call us to listen to the Spirit speaking through our young siblings in Christ. We celebrate the beginning of the school year and ask for your blessings upon the children, the educators, and their families who support them. But in this celebration of education and learning, We do not forget they are our children and families and teachers who do not have the resources they need. When systems are unjust, the outcomes are unacceptable. Today, we remember those who are beginning this school year, those who have what they need to learn and grow in safety, and those who lack supplies, teachers, safe buildings, and accommodations for all needs and abilities. We come to worship together, to lift up our young people and all those who care for them and teach them. Open our hearts to what you are saying to us today. In faith and trust, we pray as we enter into silent prayer.
Share together in reading today's prayer of reconciliation. Gracious and merciful Lord, you have offered us food for the journey. Remind us that your very life will sustain us as we witness to your love. But sometimes we let those reminders slip from our consciousness. We wallow in our difficulty, make excuses for not living the kind of life that you would have us live. Treat others in ways which are not healthy or loving. Please forgive us, Lord. Stop us in our tracks and help us to examine the many ways in which you have not served you well and the callous things we have done to others. Cleanse our spirits and our souls from these unrighteous acts and cause us to follow you more closely. Remind us again that you are the bread of life, having given yourself for us. Sustain us and encourage us in our service. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And now I invite you to come into the stillness that is within you and reveal your confession. Now hear the assurance of grace. Even though we turn our backs on God, God is ready to forgive and heal our spirits. God's love never fails, and we can rejoice in the power of that eternal love. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are healed and are forgiven. Amen. As the Lord provided peace for David's child Solomon, God has provided peace for us as beloved sons and daughters. So let us now bless one another with the peace of God's presence. I invite you to stand in body or spirit and share a sign of the peace by shaking hands, hugs, or waving to each other. May the words that are spoken build up this community. May the ears that hear receive the good news of God's grace. May the Holy Spirit move us to action so that our community may be filled with love and healing. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from 1 Kings. Then David slept with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. The time that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was firmly established. Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except that he sacrificed and offered incense at the high places. The king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, and for that was the principal high place. Solomon used to offer 1,000 burnt offerings on the altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Although I am only a little child, I do not know how to go out and come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this great people of yours?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, "Because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the lives of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I do now according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor all your life. No other king shall compare to you. If you will walk in my ways, keep my statutes and my commandments as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your life." This is the inspired word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our second reading this morning is from Ephesians 5, verses 15 through 20. "Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what is the will of the Lord. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. As you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to one another, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." The inspired word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please stand in body or spirit for our gospel reading according to John chapter 6, verses 51 through 58. "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, 'How can this man give us his flesh to eat?' So Jesus said to them, 'Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which the ancestors ate, and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. Do not place a period where God has placed a comma. God is still speaking. You may be seated." Thank you. In the cinematic realm, the character Maximus Decimus Meridius in Ridley Scott's Gladiator embodies a particular kind of human experience that resonates with many. His unwavering determination and relentless pursuit of a singular, consuming goal capture the essence of human resilience in the face of overwhelming adversity. Stripped of everything that once defined him, including his family and honor, Maximus becomes a shadow of his former self, fueled only by a burning desire for retribution. His portrayal of Maximus' journey starkly contrasts the spiritual teachings of Jesus in today's scripture reading. While Maximus is driven by a vengeful spirit and seeks a form of justice that ultimately feels hollow, Jesus offers a different path that leads to life, a profound and enduring reality that transcends the temporal pursuit of retribution. The juxtaposition of these two narratives invites reflection on the nature of human experience, the pursuit of justice, and the more profound spiritual teachings that have continued to resonate throughout the ages. Maximus' hunger is visceral, a primal desire for justice and restoration. It is a hunger born of loss, consuming passion that eclipses all else. His story resonates with human condition. We too often find ourselves consumed by singular pursuits, whether career advancement, familial obligations, or personal desires. These can become idols, eclipsing our spiritual needs. The crowd in John 6, captivated by the miracle of the loaves and fishes, mirrors this tendency. Their request for more bread reveals a spiritual shallowness, a preoccupation with the tangible over the transcendent. Beneath the surface of our desires and accomplishments lies a deeper hunger, a yearning for something more profound. C.S. Lewis described it as a homesickness for heaven, recognizing that this world is not our ultimate home. Though often suppressed, this spiritual hunger is a testament to our creation in God's image. It is a whisper of the divine within us, a longing for connection with the infinite. There's times where we feel that not enough people are being the church. Not enough people are coming to Sunday worship. And while we might have our own thoughts, we have to take a step back and see where society plays a part. And it's interesting when you talk to some folks of what they'll tell you the reason why they don't step foot into a church building. Because remember that the church is not the building. You are the church. We are the church. Without us, this is just the building. And oftentimes, I've talked about it before, so I won't go into depth, is we know LGBTQ. Being Bible thumped, being condemned to hell, so forth, so on. And we still have some folks who believe that if you're not married and you have children, then you're not being very Christian-like. And some of you is like, well, isn't that an old type of sentiment? But most of us would think that way. That's not the case. Then we have those who have been abused by the people in the church. And that could be any aspect of it. Whether it was a verbal abuse by the church people, whether it was assault by a member of the church or a member of the clergy, whether it was losing faith and trust in their leadership because of embezzlement. You think of all the different things that you've read and heard about in the news. And sometimes you don't hear about some of these things. And you wonder, why are people not coming to worship? People just don't want to get up on Sunday. Well, people are too busy doing other stuff. And yes, well, that's maybe some of it. There's a lot more to it. Why have so many turned away from just religion or even believing directly in God? And sometimes this can appear like Maximus, where they have a vengeance type of vision. Recently on, and you know I talk about social media every now and then, so I won't go into depth in this one, but part of the reason why I bring up social media is because, well, where do some of our people watch us? Social media. So it is relevant to our church community, even if some of you don't participate in social media. But what I saw this week was a video of someone who used to be, who was brought up conservative Christian, and who now denounces Christianity and God. And there's a reason why I follow him on social media, and it's not to ridicule him. It's to listen to the various reasons that he and others have stopped attending worship, have stopped believing in God. And every now and then, I will comment on there and say, hey, I hear you. And more of us need to be open to what you're saying. Because just as you expect someone else to be open to what you're saying about your faith practice, you have to do the same. It's a two-way road. And how many people out there in society don't we have that says, oh, no, no, Christianity is the only way. And if I were to say to that, one of our regulars would probably throw a shoe at me. Because not everybody who comes into this sanctuary, whether you know it or not, and if you don't, I'm not about to tell you who they are, do not necessarily believe in Christianity or in God. How many of you knew that? Maybe not a lot of you. And I don't go often sharing that thing and say, oh, so-and-so doesn't. That's really none of your business. They share it with me because they want to. And I use that as a teaching tool for us as a community. But you see, when I commented this way, it was different from other times I've commented on this person's video. Because I actually got hate. Someone says, I wish people like you did just not exist anymore. And they quote it like that because if you use another word, social media platforms will remove your comment. So you can think of what they were trying to say. And then another one said, if you're not teaching about this, then you should be, otherwise you're not a good leader. My response to that person was, how do you know that I'm not? You're making an assumption. And oftentimes we as Christians make huge assumptions. And then when we're confronted with facts, no, well, I'm just gonna disagree. So what happens at that point? See, we continue to push people out when we are not open to listening to their stories. We're so quick to have them listen to ours, but we don't pause to listen to theirs. And I could have kept on back and forth with these people on social media, but let's face it, life is too short. May respond once or twice and that's it. Why? Because we know some people, no matter what walks of life they're coming from, they just don't stop. Just like in real life, right? You just sometimes, it's best to just say, okay, because they won't stop. But I was surprised because even the creator of the video hit like on my comment, and he has before. But two other individuals basically put me down without even knowing me. And I bring that up because that often happens in our society. And as we prepare our kids to go back to school, or even adults starting a new job, or college kids going back to college or starting college, people will still make those assumptions. Some of you are aware that our little boss has been doing Taekwondo. And somebody's like, oh, that's awesome, this, that, and that's great. But you see, from my perspective, part of the reason he is in that is to learn some skills to defend himself. Because we know life is cruel out there. And while we hope and pray that it will not happen, he will be put down because of who his parents are, something he had no choice over. And if you're a parent, a grandparent, aunt, or uncle, most of us have had a kid in our lives, some aspect, you do what you can to protect your child because you cannot be there 24/7. Now, his preschool was wonderful. They did a great job. And of course, it's first congregational preschool, so. Which, they're awesome, awesome teachers there. If you're ever looking for another place to donate to, because you have an extra few bucks, drop them a check. They're non-profit, but they still have bills to pay. And their teachers do not get paid a lot. I want you to keep those things in mind as you go out there today. Because Jesus' declaration says, I am the bread of life. It's a radical reorientation. So many people out there say, oh no, Jesus was by the book and this and that. I don't know what version of the Bible they're reading. Because the one that I'm reading, he flips table, he goes off on people. He shares what he has. Oh no, socialism. Public roads are part of socialism. Public buildings are socialism. Our parks are part of socialism. Social Security, yes, we pay into it, but then it's redistributed. Part of the same system. But we ignore that oftentimes. We look at socialism, oh well, all these illegals are getting benefits. Are they? They're not. Maybe a benefit or two with minimal assistance they will receive. But there's a lot of other benefits they will not receive if they are not a citizen or a resident. See, and I bring that up because here it says a radical reorientation. I am the bread of life. Imagine if someone came up to you now in person and said, Ruth, I am the bread of life. You gotta eat me. Ruth's like, Irv? What would you do? You'd be like, this person is nuts. See, Jesus presents himself not as a fleeting satisfaction, but as eternal source of sustenance. His words challenge our limited understanding of food and nourishment, inviting us into a deeper spiritual communion. Unlike the bread that perishes, Jesus is the living bread, sustaining us physically, spiritually, emotionally, and intellectually. This nourishment transcends time and space, connecting us to the divine source of life. In many indigenous cultures, Mother Corn is celebrated as a revered deity. She symbolizes the earth's abundant bounty and life-giving power. She is deeply connected to the agricultural cycle and is regarded as a provider and sustainer of life. Cultivation and consumption of corn are woven into various rituals and ceremonies, representing the essential physical nourishment required for survival. Mother Corn's image invokes a profound sense of gratitude and reverence for the natural world, serving as a reminder of the interconnectedness between humanity and the environment. As the embodiment of sustenance, she represents a vital link between the earth's offering and the well-being of communities. In contrast, Jesus is recognizing Christian theology as the bread of life, encapsulating a higher form of sustenance that transcends the physical realm. His teachings and spiritual nourishments are believed to have the power to transform and sustain the soul on a much deeper level. This representation of Christ as the living water that quenches the thirst of the human spirit underscores the profound spiritual nourishment offered, extending beyond mere sustenance to the promise of eternal life. Therefore, these two representations, Mother Corn and Jesus as the bread of life, each carry significant cultural and spiritual meanings, offering nourishment and sustenance in their respective domains. To partake of the bread of life is to undergo a profound transformation. It is to move from a life centered on self to Christ. The shift has its challenges. It requires faith, humility, and a willingness to surrender our desires. Maximus' journey is a testament to the human capacity for resilience. It is also a reminder of the limitations of human strength. His ultimate redemption comes not through vengeance, but through the sacrifice. A metaphor of eating the flesh and drinking the blood of Christ is a powerful image of this intimate communion. It speaks to a deep, abiding connection with the divine. The spiritual nourishment is not a solitary experience, but a communal one. That's why we come together in communion. As we gather around the Lord's table, we share in the body and blood of Christ, strengthening our bonds with one another. The shared experience, like the breaking of bread in early Christian communities, fosters a sense of unity and belonging. The world can often feel like the brutal arena in which Maximus fought, tempting us with the allure of power, wealth, and fame. These false promises offer a fleeting sense of fulfillment, unable to satisfy the deepest longings of the human heart. In contrast, Jesus presents a different path, a path of life and abundance that transcends the superficial offerings of the world. As we embark on this transformational journey, we are called to consciously choose to feed on the bread of life, actively participating in the divine life. Just as bread is meant to be broken and shared, our lives are also meant to serve as a source of nourishment for others. Listen to that. Serve as a source of nourishment for others. Resonating with a selfless act of sharing and giving. When we partake of the bread of life, we are invited to hunger and thirst for righteousness, finding fulfillment in the knowledge that our deepest cravings will be satisfied in Christ. Embracing the bread of life allows us in an extraordinary transformation, from individuals consumed by earthly desires into vessels of godless, boundless love and grace. As we carry this invitation with us into the world, let us remain open to the transformative power of the bread of life, allowing it to ignite a profound change within us and radiate God's love and grace to those around us. Amen. Thank you.
We join together now in a new creed. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in the true man, Jesus, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by his Spirit. We trust him. He calls us to be his church, to celebrate his presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
At this time, I invite all of our kids who brought their backpacks to come forward, and even if you didn't come forward, and anybody who is starting a new school year, if you're an adult who's going to start college, then come up front. Let me see your backpack.
It's
a lot. It almost matches your shirt. When did you start school, or did you start? You started already. Oh, let's see. So does he. When do you start?
Friday.
And I know we have at least two district staff as well. So, how are you feeling about starting a new school year? Good? Yeah? How are you feeling about starting school? Any other word besides good? Okay. Jessica? There you go. So, starting a new school year starts with what? Being brave, right? Because you don't know what you're going to expect. Or the obvious assignments. I know you're just laughing at it. It's okay. That's the whole point. So, going back to school always invites big feelings to come along with us. And those feelings can be different for everyone. Whether you're starting school year for the first time, moving to a new school, you're going to a new school, or staying at the same school. Are you still at the same school? Yeah? You're still at the same school. We can all feel happy.
Last time, the first time I was not sleeping
here. Lucky you. Can I take a nap at work? Why? You take a nap? So we can feel happy, nervous, sometimes we can get scared, curious, and what else? Excited, right? Are you excited about doing new stuff? What other emotion are you feeling besides good? Impatient? Okay. How much more do you need? Good. Sometimes we can even feel all those feelings at the same time. And that's okay too. But did you know that God is always with us? Did you? No matter where you go and what you're feeling, God is there. As we start a new school year, I want to give you this special backpack tag so that whenever you look at it, you can remember God loves you and is always with you, no matter what. And because I know sometimes the world can be the world, it still has affirmation without the religious aspect on it at all. It still affirms who you are, and it's still something God would tell you. So, do you want to choose one? Or two? Jessica? Okay. Debbie and Jim, when you come up in a minute. Anybody else who works in a school or school district? No? Okay. Rita? Not original Rita. Rita number two. Because if not, they're going to go ask Rita, when did you start working at a school? So, along with the backpack tag, I also want to share a blessing with you. A blessing that is something you receive so you can open your hands like you're ready to receive a special gift. As I speak, imagine the words are dancing, floating, and fluttering all around. And watch them as they land on your hands and on your backpack. If you want to receive it, the blessing, and put it in your heart. So may these tags remind you that God is always with you. As you sit and as you stand, as you learn and as you play, in every fear, in every celebration, may you know God, your friend, is always there. Do you want to come for a blessing? Rita? No, you don't have to say it. I won't be that cool. Tayo is surprised because this flowers always go pretty far. God, fresh starts and new beginnings. We bring ourselves, our big feelings, and our backpacks to you. In our backpacks, we carry blank pages, sharpened pencils, and pointy crayons. In our hearts, we carry big feelings, unanswered questions, and hopeful expectations. There are endless possibilities of what this new year may bring, of what might we learn, who we might meet, and who might become. God, our friend, is always with us. Be with us through it all. Be with us as we ride the bus. Be with us as we walk. Be with us as we buckle seatbelts, zip up jackets, and tie shoes. However, we get there, and whatever we wear, bless this journey into something new. For the grown-ups going back to school, with us, God, be with them too. Thank you for our teachers, school and district staff, helpers, caregivers, and leaders, and for all they do to help us learn and grow. God, our friends, who's full of wonder, fill their hearts and bless their hands. Amen. You have to pick up the spot.
Yes.
Here. Yeah. With you, every transition and new start is a reminder of your goodness, for you are always creating fresh, amazing things in us and through us. Though we are sad about the summer ending, we are grateful for this school year. We appreciate the opportunity to learn and grow, knowing it is one of the biggest privileges we have. With thanks and love, we now offer everything we are to you, asking for your blessing. We pray as and for students of all ages, abilities, and backgrounds. We pray for our hearts and all they hold, excitement and nervousness, disappointment and hope. We give you all our loves and fears. We pray for steady self-esteem and deepening resilience. We pray for our minds that they will expand in wonder and celebration, learning not just from the books studied from the people beside us. Open our minds with a willingness to be changed in unexpected ways and settle our thoughts, loops, in peaceful places.
Lord God, hold us in our prayers.
We pray for our hands that they will reach out to help, welcome, and care. Bless our hands with patience and dedication as they grip pencils and tap on keyboards, swish paintbrushes and clap in song, grip monkey bars and lunchbox handles, spin wheelchair tires, and basketballs. We pray for our mouths, that they will speak words bringing life and connection. Help us to use our words to honor the dignity and belovedness of all. Remind us to open our mouths for deep belly breaths when we're feeling anxious or afraid. We pray for our feet, that they will move toward those different from us and help others in safe ways. Plant our feet next to those who feel alone and bless our steps down hallways and sidewalks. We know you are with us whenever our feet go or stay.
Lord God, hold us in our prayers.
We pray for our eyes, that they may see ourselves and others with compassion. Point our eyes towards those who are forgotten or struggling. Grow in us the flexibility to see from all kinds of angles. Bless what and how we see, whether we're looking at a screen, a whiteboard, or the beauty of a person's face, and help us see with the most important eyes, the eyes of the Spirit within us.
Lord God, hold us in our prayers.
We pray for our ears, that they will genuinely listen to all voices, especially those that haven't been listened to much. When things get noisy, help us to listen extra carefully for your voice. Help us hear with the most important ears, the ears of the Spirit within us.
Loving God, hold us in our prayers.
We say a special prayer for parents. As the start of a new school year is always another leap of faith, wrap them with your reassuring love, that they entrust their children and trust in you when questions will remain unanswered and the realm of control is final. Bless them with peace and the promise you are right there with their children, whether heading to preschool or driving to college.
Lord God, hold us in our prayers.
We also pray now for teachers, staff, and administrators. Bless these faithful servants with courage and confidence, knowing you are in their classroom with a steady hand on their shoulder. Give them peace, patience, and balance in the pressures they face, and bravery to build structures and systems which justly serve all children. Give them delight in the young ones before them, and recognition of the sweet ways children are also teachers.
Lord God, hold us in our prayers.
We pray for health and wholeness, fun and growth, surprise and amazement for the school year ahead, knowing you will hold us all the way through. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, as we continue to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Y'all probably thought I was never going to shut up with a prayer, huh? We see God's work in acts of honesty and justice. We touch God's covenant in moments of mercy and compassion. Let us be God's instrument in the world as we collect today's offering. Surround us each day. We thank you for inspiring our actions and feeding our creativity. We praise you for warming our hearts and enlightening our minds. May these gifts go forth into your world and be breath and blessing to those in need. Amen.
Please stand in body or spirit for our benediction and remain standing for our last and final hymn this morning.
Children, families, and all who love them, go out into the beautiful world that God has made. Go and play. Go and learn. Go and love others. May you be filled with loving kindness for yourself and everyone around you. May the prayers of your faith community keep you safe, healthy, and full of joy. Amen.